them into our church. And they're going to be having something special, I think, today at LCS, if I'm not mistaken. Like, they're going to go and pray for LCS. Something like that. I was told about that, yes. Oh, they canceled. Oh, okay. Never mind. Okay, well, if you have no other announcements, I would like you guys to prepare your hearts for the next part of the service. And I would like to invite the praise team to come up and help us get to where we need to get, which is before the throne of God.
Good morning. Good morning and happy Sabbath. I would like to welcome you all again to the last Sabbath of the year. And just with a show of hands, how many of you are happy to be here today? Just a few hands? Okay. Well, it is such a blessing to be in the house of the Lord today and to be counted among the living. Our first song for today is To God Be the Glory. And I'll invite you to stand with us as we sing praises to our Lord for all he has done for us and all he will continue to do.
Great things he has done, so long. eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
Invite the deacons and deaconesses to come up front, please.
To bow down.
for the order of prayer. So I invite you to come up front if you're able to, or you can kneel wherever you are and just give your cares and praises to the Lord.
And your friends are few. There is someone who cares for you. When your heart breaks inside, when no one stands beside, there is someone who cares for you. Father, this morning, as we come in your presence, Father, we look back and see the things we have done, where we have been, that the prodigal son says, I will arise and go home. Father, we will come home, Lord, to you today, because who can return to? Who has the joy and the peace that we need? Who has the love that we need? So we turn towards you today, Lord, and ask that you forgive us for where we've been, what we've done. Forgive us for the past, the mistake we've made. Forgive us, Lord. Father, we can't have peace today, Lord, without forgiveness. We can't have peace today without the joy that comes from you to recognize that you have taking away all our sins and shame and disgrace. You have removed everything from us that should not be there, and so we can rejoice that we have found salvation. Father, I pray this morning for those who are here for the very first time. I never heard about the salvation that comes to mankind. But may they hear something today during the service that will tell them that surely there's somebody who cares for them. Someone who cares more than a father and a mother. Father, today we give you all the honor and the praise, the wonderful name, because you are worthy to be praised. There ain't none God like you. You're the only true God, the Savior of all mankind. Father, we pray today for those who are sick today, Lord. Oh, they need your helping hand, Lord. They need a touch of the Almighty. Women say, if I only touch his garment, I shall be made whole. Help us, Lord, today to touch and be made whole today. Father, for those today, Lord, who need a job, provide for them today, Lord. Father, for those who need a bill to be paid, Lord, provide the money to pay the bill, Lord. For those who need a place to stay, may they find a place to stay, Lord. For help us to understand what the Bible says, we have all things in common, what that really means, Lord. For we pray today for those this morning, Lord, who are troubled, distressed, oppressed, depressed, cast down, we pray today, Lord, that they may be like David, who encourage himself in the Lord. May they find courage and comfort today in God. Oh, Father, we pray today, Lord, for the pastor in a very special way, Lord. He had a tremendous responsibility ahead of him in this campaign, Lord. We ask that your Holy Spirit would give him the wisdom he needs to guide and lead this flock. Father, we pray for all the leaders in this congregation, Lord. May they learn how to lead, Lord. May they lead, let you lead them, Lord. Father, we pray that your will, Lord, be done in this place. We surrender, Lord, to you today, every aspect of our life, every corner. Take control, Father, we pray today. For the one today, Lord, who shall break the bread of life, we pray, Lord, that his life, hallelujah. Lord, we pray, Lord, that he be under the blood of Jesus today, Lord. When he speak, may he not speak because of what he knows, but may he speak under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. May you speak to him today, Lord, to someone, Lord, who needs to hear a word. Oh, Father, we just ask today, Lord, to set us free. Lord, we need to have that joy. The Bible says the joy of the Lord is your strength. Father, we pray today, Lord, that you just give us that joy. Oh, that when people see us, they see that truly we are happy in the Lord. For I pray for the young people, Lord, in this place, Lord. Many of them are missing, Lord. Where they are this morning, we pray that your Holy Spirit will convict them. That the prodigal son, they may even know to return to the fold. For wherever they are this morning, Lord, we pray that they will find relief from their troubled minds. And so, Father, we thank you so much. We give you all the praise again to your name. Father, hear our cry to you, Lord. Answer. Believe it in your hand. We believe it, we accept it, and we claim it in Jesus' name. Amen.
The scripture reading today is Isaiah 56, verse 7. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar. For mine house shall be called the house of prayer for all people. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. And this morning, we are going to sing from our own dialect. So just in case if you don't understand it, it's so nice that we have a slide so you can read what it means.
Sabbath. It's nice to see so many beautiful shining faces this Sabbath morning. So many faces, familiar faces, family and friends, a lot of faces that are new and unfamiliar to me, but you're still all family. And so we just thank God that you're here with us. I'm just going to take a second here to get set up. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Grant Bell. I'm a member of this church. But you haven't seen me much lately because I've been away. God sent me to school nearly 3.5 years ago to enter the ministry. And so I have one more semester left to go. I can see the light. Thank you. Praise God for that. I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Who knew at this stage in life that this is where God would lead me, right? We never know what God's going to do in our lives, but it's a matter of when we surrender our lives to Him and we listen to what God is saying to us, it's in those moments that God does miraculous things. And we're at the stage with this church where we're looking forward to some pretty miraculous things, aren't we? And so again, I welcome all of you who are visiting with us, those of you who are watching online, friends and family. It's a time of celebration, isn't it? It's a privilege and honor to be here this particular Sabbath because this is a special one. We're talking about history. We're talking about legacy. This church is built, what, 72 years ago, if I'm not mistaken? 72 years ago, this church was built, and a legacy was formed, and now we're on the cusp of taking that legacy to a new church building, heading in a whole new direction by God's grace and mercy. Amen? And so, as I look around and see so many of you, you know, it's a time of us. We just finished the holiday season, didn't we? And it's a time of reflection, a time of family, a time of looking back and remembering those fond memories. And as we look back at the church history that this church has provided to this community, we can look back in our own lives and see what God has done for us. And it's a blessing for me today, especially because here I'm with my family, my wife, my father, one of my father's best friends, and a dear, dear friend of mine. You know me, I get emotional. And, wow, I didn't expect that. But my brother and old soccer coach from many, many years ago, Manuel Pereira, is here visiting us for the first time. Never thought I'd see this day. But it's a huge blessing. Huge blessing. And so I thank God for that. And I pray, too, that over this holiday season, that you, too, took time to reflect on those moments that God has blessed you in a special and a wonderful way, in ways that we never seem to expect, never seem to understand, but we know that God's hand is in that moment because He does something only He can do. Amen? And so I want to thank Dr. Marion Kosovan, our dear pastor and leader here, who invited me to come and speak today. You know, I was thinking when he asked me to speak, it's kind of ironic that this is the third time in 5 years I've preached the last Sabbath of the year in this church. Maybe it's becoming a tradition, who knows? Maybe you'll be sick and tired of me, who knows? But I'm grateful and thankful to be here. Now, I apologize, typically I don't have my laptop here in front of me. I wasn't able to get my notes printed off, so I apologize for the distraction. But I want to take just a moment for us to focus on all the blessings God has given us throughout this year. And if you haven't done that yet, I strongly encourage you to take some time just to sit in His presence and reflect on what God has done for you this past year. This past year may have been a year of wonderful victories and blessings and prosperity and a year of just abundance that you've never had before. For others, it's been a year of challenges and setbacks, losses of family, friends, and loved ones. Just yesterday, I saw one of my best friend of over 34 years, lowered into the ground, died way too soon. Way too soon. But it's a reality check to make sure that my heart is right with God, because unfortunately, I don't know if His ever was. We grew up together, we worked together, been best friends. Comes from an Asian culture, has their own beliefs, their own traditions. He knew I was a Christian. He knew I was going to school to be a pastor, supported me in all of it, but it was a sudden act of mercy, I really think, that God took him when He did. It's unfortunate, it's sad, but that's life, isn't it? But the thing that woke me up in this moment was to sit there and to look at him in his deathbed, tubes in his throat, unable to talk, unable to communicate. And just that look in his eyes, he just didn't want to go. And that's the same for many of us. We just don't want to go, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with not wanting to go when we're in that moment. But the difference between us who have a relationship with Jesus Christ and those who don't is that we have a hope in glory. We have a hope of a resurrection. And when I'm looking into my friend's eyes and he's holding my hand and he's in agony and he can't communicate, and I'm just looking into his face and I'm just thinking, what are you thinking? What are you feeling in this moment? Are you afraid to go because you're afraid of what's next? Because those who don't know Christ don't know what's next. For some, they believe there's nothing. This is it. I'm done. My time here is over. I've played my role. See ya. For others, that sense of insecurity and that hopeless feeling of not knowing what's going to happen. And it was really, I'm grateful I had the experience of that bedside moment with him. But it shook me to the core. Because that's the first time I've been that close to someone on their deathbed, looking into their eyes and not knowing where they're going to be. God gave me moments to speak to him privately, quickly. But I walked out of that hospital room thinking, Lord, did I do enough? Did I do enough? And I won't know until we look into the eyes of Christ. And if he's there with us, praise God. If he's not, then it's a heartbreak. But it's a loss that we have to endure, unfortunately. The Bible tells us that in that moment, there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now I know why. We've heard it, we've read it, we've thought about it, but it really hit home for the first time, seeing my friend in his deathbed. And so as we look back in history, the history of this church, we've lost many loved ones here, but we've seen many new faces come, haven't we? There's growth and there's glory in those moments when a new body, a new person comes in this church and gives their life to Christ. It's sadness when we lose those that we love, but as the angels rejoice when a new soul is given, what more can we be more grateful for? And so as we look back at the history of the church, I want to take you back to another day in history. It's July 20th, 1969. Anybody remember what that day was? It was the day that Neil Armstrong made his famous speech, his now famous speech, as he stepped down off the lunar module onto the moon. And just before he did that, what did he say? One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. It was a huge historic moment, changed the history of this earth. But that was a leap, a step of faith. That first step that he took was a step of faith. Why? Because they had no idea what to expect. They have gone where no man has gone before, doing something that no man has ever done before, and they had no idea what to expect. This church is in a similar place, isn't it? We're about to embark on our own journey. We're about to take our own first step as we break ground in the new property in the next few months ahead. But no one here knows how big or small the challenges we will face in that endeavor. And I use the words big and small to emphasize the importance of our faith in God in leading us in this project. It's our faith that if it's strong and we're fully surrendered to his leading and the purpose for this church, every problem and challenge we will face will seem small and every victory will seem large. But if we step into that moment weak of faith, every challenge will seem great. And every victory will seem small. I have this small wooden boat on my coffee table at home. And it's just a small little thing, but it's got a printed, on the sails, there's a printed saying. And it says, don't tell God how big your storm is. Tell the storm how big your God is. I love that saying. It's simple. But it hits right to the point, doesn't it? And it reminds me every time I see it that I need to be surrendered to Christ in every moment of my day. And that's something I struggle with. I am challenged with. I'm in school and doing so much. And it's overwhelming at times. But you sit there and think, and we try to do all of these things on our own. We try to do it on our own strength, and I've paid the price for it. I've been ill. The things have happened. There's just things that just shouldn't have been had I been fully surrendered to the will of Christ. And you'd think at this stage in life I would have learned that by now. But we're stubborn, aren't we? We're independent. We want to do things on our own. Why? Because it helps establish our purpose, our identity, and who we think we are. But the only identity that truly matters is who Jesus says we are. And that's only manifested in our actions and our deeds and our submission to Him and trusting in His will to guide us and to lead us in our lives. And that's exactly what we need to do as a church now. You've heard it preached in this church. If you've been a member here or coming here for any period of time, you've been coming here for a while and you've heard Pastor Marion, Pastor Wesley, Pastor Ken when he was here, David Jameson when he was here, talking about the importance of unity as a church. In order for us to move ahead with this new venture, to do what God is calling us to do, we know, the Bible tells us that we need to be in one accord. We just need to look at the upper room experience, don't we? But you see, I want to offer a few words of wisdom here. And it's not my wisdom, believe me. It says, but the one thing I do know is that nothing threatens the devil more than a praying church that is united and moving forward with the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Did you hear what I said? In that statement is everything we will ever need to know to defeat the enemy in any challenge that he ever throws at us. What was the first one? Nothing threatens the devil more than what? A praying church. And that is what? United and moving forward. And moving forward with what? The power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. See, a church may be a praying church, but if it's not united and does not have the power of the anointing of the Holy Spirit, it's just simply weak and feeble. If the church is united, but there's no prayer, and there's no anointing of the Holy Spirit, we have a great church with fantastic potlucks, but we have no God. And it's scripturally impossible for any church to have the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit if that church is not united and it does not pray. So just as the disciples stepped out in faith to follow Christ and change the world, the founding members of this church stepped out in faith over 70 years ago to trust God and obey His leading in them to build this church. It's because of their faith and taking that first step that has allowed God to use this church to change the lives of everyone who has stepped in it or have been helped by those who have stepped out of it and reached into the community to touch the lives of those around us. It's because of their faith to trust God and obey His direction to build His church that we now have the opportunity to take the first step in showing the generations that will follow the faith that we have to trust God and to obey His direction to build our new church on Chatterton Way. And it's by faith we will trust and obey Him to see it through to its completion. It's by faith we will trust and obey Him to lead this church in reaching this community, this city, and as Pastor Dave Jameson mentioned, to the entire world. But do we have the faith to dream big enough to do that? See, I don't know if you're like me, but I tend to put God in a box. And I limit what He can do in my life simply because it fits into what I understand. But in doing so, I am negating so much of what God can do for me and through me just simply because of my own ignorance and my own selfishness. I pray that doesn't happen to us as a church as we step out and build this new church and move forward from where we are today to where we know God wants us to be. All we have to do is get out of the way. So we owe a huge debt of gratitude to all those that by faith trust and obeyed God to build this church. But we owe an even greater debt to God who built His church, the people, in Victoria long before this church was ever built.
See, it's an exciting new venture for us, and we need to remember that the church is not a building. It is the people, and if we're not careful now, that new church will become an idol. All of us know examples. I can think of one almost immediately, where a new church was built, and the church became their god. Look what we built. Look what we have done. Look how we have positioned ourselves in this community. Look what we're doing for you. But there's an extremely important aspect of that formula that's missing. And that's God. It's the Holy Spirit. So it's real easy for us to rest on our laurels because basically the hard work's been done now, hasn't it? All we're waiting for is the ground to be broken, the church to be built, and we can sit back and just rest on our laurels and then look forward to the day where we can move into the new church. But there's a danger in that, and I'll get to that shortly. But you see, if we take the stand where our church becomes our god, it becomes our idol, that's very, very dangerous ground. And all we need to do is look at King Nebuchadnezzar, don't we? And see what happened to him and his kingdom when he stood there on his balcony looking out to what he had created and said, look what I have built. Where did he end up? I don't have a fondness for grass. I don't know about you guys. So we need to be careful that we don't build something out of arrogance, out of entitlement or animosity, and create division amongst ourselves simply because we think we built it. If this new church is ever to be what God wants us to make it to be, we all must take a first step of our own. But that first step won't be taken by our feet. It'll be taken on our knees. Acts 2 tells us that the first step the disciples had to take in order to receive the Holy Spirit and his power was what? They came together in the upper room in one accord, in unity and what? Prayer. Prayer. The church here is now in a very precarious position. You see, it's very easy for us now to sit back and think we've done all that we need to do. Now we can simply just watch the ground be broken and the church be built. But let me make this suggestion, that it's during this time of waiting, this time right now, is the most important time this church will ever face. It's a time that will determine the future purpose and mission of that church. Before those walls are ever erected, the future of that church will already be determined. How do I know that? Because it'll be determined by where our heart's at, where our minds are at, and where and who we serve and worship. It's all dependent upon whether we're surrendered to the will of God or we're trying to accomplish what we think we should accomplish in this city. And if we let this time pass without aggressively seeking God's will for the church and for every member in it and every person to walk through the doors of that church, we're in big trouble. God's will for the church and every member in it, the devil will use the time to tear down every purpose and every member to the point of making the new church nothing more than walls and glass. Now, it's a somber warning. It's a somber thought. And I hate to be the bearer of what could be bad news. But at the same time, we've seen it happen time and time again where a church, thinking it's moving forward in the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit, and God is left behind. And what happens? I don't want a single person in this church now or ever to be on the receiving words of Christ when they said, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name? Did I not reach the lost? Did I not feed the hungry in your name? Did I not cast out demons in your name? And what does Jesus say to them? Be gone from me, for I know not who you are. So it's real easy to play Christian, especially at a time like this. It's an exciting time. It's an easy time to be excited and to call yourself a Christian. But at the end of the day, are we living being a Christian? As Pastor Dave mentioned when he was here, or in his last service in Church in the Valley, pardon me, he said, talking about Christmas, it's not just celebrating Christmas, it's being Christmas. It's not just celebrating a new church, it's about being a new church. That church is us, isn't it? That church is us. So the first step in the new year for this church must be constantly coming together in prayer, seeking God's purpose, his plan, and his will for this church, and praying for the constant anointing of the Holy Spirit to protect us, to empower us, and to submit to his will for this church, whatever it may be. There's so much still that we don't know about this project, what God's will and his purpose is for this new church, and the only way we will ever know what those are is by taking that required first step according to Scripture, and that's to be joined together constantly in prayer. What was our opening scripture? Isaiah 56, 7. These I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for what? All nations. Is that a limiting statement? No. It's not just our community. It's just not just our neighborhood. It's not just this city. For all nations. Pastor Dave pointed out the emphasis of the vision that God can give us so far beyond the walls of this church or the new church or the city of Victoria or even the province of British Columbia. The people in this church can go and touch the lives of those all over the world if we are willing to let God lead. Are you willing, is my question. Only you know the answer to that. And if you're not, are you willing to be willing? I pray and hope that you are. So where does the presence of God reside today? See, most people look at the scripture and they assume that he's talking about the church being a house of prayer, the building, because these words are spoken to the Jews in regard to the temple. And that's where the presence of God was at the time. But again, I ask you again, where does the presence of the Holy Spirit reside today? In you and in me. So that means each one of us is a house of prayer. And together we come unified to be a collective house of prayer, just as the disciples were in the upper room. And it wasn't until then, when they were in unity and in prayer, that they were anointed by the Holy Spirit. And then what did they do? They turned the then known world upside down. What a vision that is. Did they know what they were doing? Was that a leap of faith? How exciting. Again, we're in a position where we can have a whole new beginning. The past is done away with. Whatever baggage you've got, whatever problems with other members you have, whatever your history may be, when we walk out of the doors of this church today for the very last time, we can leave all of that behind, and it can be buried in the rubble of what this building will become. We have a chance to do something new, to do something exciting, to be a part of something that has never been done in this city before in our generation for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. That's to build a new building and to have a whole new beginning and do something different and bigger than we could ever imagine for the kingdom of God if we just simply surrender to him and allow him to work in our lives. Amen? Amen. You should be excited. You should be excited. I'm excited for you, and I'm not even here. You see, it's in surrender that we must fully trust God and obey him and all that he directs us to do. We need to be willing, then, to trust and obey. If that's the desire of your heart this morning, if the thought of a new beginning has inspired you, if the prompting of the Holy Spirit is calling you to do more, to be more, to live more for his glory and his honor, then I'm going to ask you to stand in faith and come to the front, and we're going to come together in a moment of prayer and unity to surrender our hearts and our lives to him in a moment of trust and obedience. Because it begins now. Like I said, we're in a position where we're in a vulnerable place where it's so easy for us to just to sit back and watch the church get built. But what does the Bible say about idleness? I'd hate to see that happen to this church. It's so exciting what we have ahead of us. But we have to be completely surrendered to God every moment of every day until those doors open and then every day thereafter. But see, that's the beauty of God, isn't it? All he does, he asks us just to simply to surrender. Give him all that we have, as little or as much as that may be, and he will take it and do miraculous things with it. He will give us the strength to do it. He will give us the words to speak, the power to overcome. He will open all doors. He will give us everything we need to do what he has called us to do. All he asks is for a willing spirit. I'm not much. But I praise God and thank him for I am now. Because I wouldn't be graduating in 4 months from now if I didn't take that first step of faith. Believe me, I had every reason not to. Look at me. Do I look like a university student to you? No. But that's a gift God gave me that was taken away from me so many years ago, and he is now restoring with the locusts of Eden. What have the locusts stolen in your life? What is it that God wants to give you back? And then some, if you simply let him. Do you even know? I fought this call for almost 15 years because I thought I knew what was best. Lord, I'm already serving in ministry. I'm already doing all the things you're calling me to do. I'm doing visitations. I'm teaching Sabbath school. I'm preaching. I'm singing up front. I'm doing all of those things. Why do you want to send me to school so I can sit behind a desk for 4 years and take me away from what you're having me to do to sit there and do what? That was a huge, huge battle between God and I. But I ask you, what's the battle that you're facing with God right now? What are you not surrendering to God? What are you not giving him control over that's preventing you from doing wonderful things for him? It doesn't mean you're up here standing preaching a sermon to a church full of people. It's irrelevant what God is calling you to do because no one person's gifts is any less important than another. And I tell you, from standing up here as often as I do, I can tell you that it isn't what we do or say up here that makes a difference. It's what you do out there that makes the difference. That's where the church is built. It's not built by me standing here and saying all these wonderful things and praising the name of God, as wonderful as that is. It's designed for the Holy Spirit to inspire you, to motivate you, to depend on him, to go and do the things he's calling you to do. Amen? You guys okay this morning? So again, if that is your heart and that is what God is prompting you to do, then I'm going to ask you to come to the front right now on our knees, and we're going to pray together in unity for the blessing and the anointing of the Holy Spirit as we move forward from this church building today. Amen? Amen. Please come. Praise God. And if you're unable to come to the front for whatever reason, that's perfectly okay. All I'm asking, and all God is asking, is for a surrendered heart. And you can do that right where you are. This may be the first step for you in stepping out in faith and trusting God to lead in your life. And if that's the case, then praise God. Praise God. This may be the first time you've been a part of such a project as building a new church. Praise God. May it not be the last. May this church plant churches and build churches all over the world for his glory. Let's pray. Our most gracious and loving Father, Lord God, we just are so humbled by your might, by your power, by the creative force of the spoken word that brings life into existence. And Father, as this church is about to be torn down to rubble, we thank you for all that you have done through this church. We thank you for every member that's ever been a part of the growth and development of this church from the first day it opened till now, the last day that it closes. We thank you for what you have done in the lives of all of those that have been a part of this and all those out in the community that have been touched by those that have been a part of this church and the moving of your Holy Spirit. But Father, I ask now that it does not end here, that we do not rest on our laurels, that Father, that we come together as a church daily in our own lives and as often as possible in the weeks and months to come together as a church in unity, in prayer, earnestly seeking your will and purpose for this church. Because Lord, it's no mystery that this church building is being built because of your hand working in this church. We know that. But Father, what we don't know is what you want us to do with it. And so we surrender ourselves to you, to come before you, Lord, with open, surrendered, and willing hearts, to hear your voice, to do what you're calling us to do, to be humble enough to receive what you want us to do, despite our own biases, despite our own agendas, and what we think is best for this church and for this community. Help us, Lord, not to put you in a box, but to humble ourselves in meekness and lowliness, to hear your voice. Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit will touch the hearts and minds of every single person here and every person watching online, every person, every member of this church that's not here with us today. I pray that you impart your wisdom and discernment collectively and united so that this church knows exactly what its mission is, what its purpose is, what its calling is, and that every member of this church knows that for themselves, that they know what their gifts are, what their talents are, and that you will give them opportunity to use them if they just surrender themselves to you. And it's in that moment of surrender, Lord, that great and mighty things will happen for this church and in this community and the world around us. So, Father, I'm excited for what you're about to do for us and through us. And I pray here that everyone else is excited and looking forward to what you're going to do for us. Father, we praise you and give you all the glory for this now, in advance of every person that that new church will reach. We give you the glory for it now. We thank you, Father. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We pray this now in Jesus' precious, powerful, and holy name. Amen. Amen. And amen. Thank you. And so as we're about to transition to the communion aspect of the service, I want to take you back to my opening story. You see, before Neil Armstrong took that first step down off the lunar module onto the landing and gave us that now famous statement, there was another first that took place on that lunar module. Some of you may know, some of you may not. But what that first was before they even stepped out of the lunar module, Buzz Aldrin radioed NASA control, and he asked for everyone listening all around the world to take a few moments of silence to pause and contemplate this monumental event, and to give thanks for it in their own way. And so in that moment of silence, he took out a small plastic container of some wine and some bread. Now, he was given permission by his church to take to the moon the chalice that his church used for communion. And as he was in that lunar module, 1/6 gravity, he took that wine, poured it into the chalice slowly, and he said it was beautiful because that wine started to climb up the sides of the cup and just hover there before it settled down into the cup, and he realized where he was. He then partook of the wine, then the bread, and he had communion there on the moon. Now, his plan was to have this broadcast to the whole world, but it never did get broadcast, sadly, because unfortunately, NASA was in the midst of dealing with a lawsuit put against them by the atheist, Madeline Marie O'Hare, if those of you remember. She wanted a ban on NASA astronauts practicing religion on Earth, in space, or around and about the moon. The audacity, the boldness. And yet, her step of faith prevented that communion being broadcast all over the world. Now I ask you this. If the devil can do that in somebody who's following him, what can God do in those that follow him? My Bible says, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Buzz Aldrin said later, in a magazine interview, he said that, interestingly enough, the first liquid poured out on the moon and the first food that was eaten on the moon were the elements of communion. We're going to transition now into our own communion, something we here at the church do once every quarter. Quite honestly, I don't think that's nearly enough. I may be a little biased, but I think we need to celebrate the communion in our hearts and minds, if nothing else, every single day. Amen? And so this may be the first time for you. This may be a first step that you've partaken in communion. And if you're here visiting, if you've given your life to Christ, if you surrendered your heart to him and he is your Lord and Savior, you are more than welcome to celebrate this gift of communion, this celebration with us. But one thing that's also unique to our church that I wish other churches did as well is that we also share in the humble act of ordinance of service by the act of foot washing. Just as Jesus Christ washed the disciples' feet in that upper room, in the Last Supper, in that act of humility, the King, the Creator, the God of all the universe, placed himself in the lowliest of positions in the known world at that time, a foot washer. Stripped himself naked, wrapped himself in a towel, and he served. If nothing else sums up what we need to be doing as a church and what we need to be taking to the world around us, it's that very act of service. It's by a humble heart that God can do miraculous things. And so now, as we shift to the communion service, again, I just ask that if you're willing and able, please celebrate this service and this ceremony with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
We're going to ask all those that are going to be taking part of the foot washing to please go in a very orderly fashion downstairs. And the kids, they will be having their story right now by Brother Ebron. Yes. And I'm going to ask all the children to please come to the front to hear the story of this morning.
You guys can sit over here. Kids, you come over here. Sit there. Sit here on this bench. Waishe, Jabu, come. We're going to sit on the bench. When this bench is full, we're going to have some people sit in the back one, but you guys come. Come on, come on, come on. Right there. Sit down. Do we have all the kids up? Are all the kids up here? All right. All right. I'm going to sit just here. So, all right, kids. Yeah, okay. Well, when they come up, they'll have their seat. So, kids, I got a video for you. It's going to be about Zacchaeus. What's one thing that we... Who's Zacchaeus? You're going to find out soon. What's one thing that... has anyone else heard of Zacchaeus? Yes, you've heard of Zacchaeus? Yeah? What's one thing you know about Zacchaeus?
He was a wise man.
Okay, I mean, maybe. I don't know. But what does the Bible say about Zacchaeus? Jordan, do you know?
I don't know.
Was Zacchaeus tall?
Short.
He was what?
Short.
Yeah, Zacchaeus was a short guy. And what was Zacchaeus' job?
Well, he was trying to see Jesus when he was talking to his disciples.
That is true. 100% true. And his job? What was his job, his occupation? What did he do for money? How did he get his money? He collected taxes. Yeah, he was a tax collector. And sometimes he'd scrape a little off the top, too. We'll get into that in the story. All right. Hit me, Luke. We're going to run the video now.
Zacchaeus. So part of God's story is about Zacchaeus, and it begins like this. Once there was a man named Zacchaeus, let's call him Zac, who lived in a town called Jericho. He was short, and he didn't have many friends. In fact, most people hated Zac. That's because he worked as a tax collector. See, back then, people paid taxes, just like now. But instead of sending money to the government, there were men in every city whose job was taking tax money from people. Problem is, those men usually lied. Zac, like most, took a lot of extra money from a lot of people. And all those people hated him. Anyway, one day Jesus came to Zac's town, and Zac wanted to see him. But so did everybody else. And remember how Zac was really short? Well, he couldn't see Jesus over everybody else's head. So guess what he did? He actually climbed up into a tree to look out over everybody. Now, imagine a grown man climbing up in a tree in the middle of a crowd. People probably thought he was crazy or weird, but Zac was willing to look weird if it meant getting closer to Jesus. From up in the tree, Zac watched as Jesus walked up. Jesus said, "Zacchaeus, hurry down. Today is my day to be a guest in your home." This was kind of like a famous person inviting themselves over. Except way better. This invitation would change Zac's life. Zac scrambled down the tree to take Jesus to his house. Maybe he thought Jesus didn't know about all the money he had taken or how everybody hated him. But Jesus did know, and he loved Zac anyways. Other people saw this and they were mad. They said, "Jesus has gone into the house of a sinner." They wondered how Jesus could love somebody who had lied and stole their money. The great thing is, Jesus loves all of us, even after we've done things we deserve to get in trouble for, or even after we actually get in trouble. When we see that Jesus loves us anyway, it makes us want to show that kind of love to others. At least that's what happened to Zac. Right away, he wanted to make things right with the people he had hurt. He knew that just saying, "I'm sorry," wasn't enough. So he told Jesus, "I'm going to give half of what I have to the poor, and anyone I cheated, I will pay back 4 times the amount of money I took." When Jesus saw that Zac was willing to accept his love and turn around and show it to others, he said, "My friend, today God has rescued you." And even though Zac had been a liar and a thief who was hated by everyone, he became a friend of Jesus and a part of God's family that very day. And that's the story of Zacchaeus. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version.
Good.
Zac was short.
Got it, Luke.
He was a tax collector.
Perfect. All right, so... What did we learn about Zacchaeus?
He always wants more than a little.
All right, one second.
went up into a tree to see God.
There you go.
He wanted to be rich, and he was a tax collector.
Yeah, this is also true. Anything else, guys? Yeah.
He gave the money that the people gave back.
That's right. Yeah, exactly. He realized that he had done something wrong, and so he wanted to do something right. He wanted to make it right. Right? Okay. So that's what we learned about Zacchaeus. And how do you think Zacchaeus felt after Jesus told him that he was saved? Okay.
Happy.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And you know what? Through the power of God, even though we've done things that are wrong, we can make it right, you know? And that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to do our best to make things right. And I think that concludes our children's story. So, yeah, I know, right? Pretty short. Almost. You can go back to your seat. Well, okay, give me a second. So we're going to pray first. Hello, Mario. Since you're so energetic, I'll let you pray for us. Let's pray together. Come on, guys. Let's get on our knees and do the whole thing. We'll do the whole thing. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your love and your mercy towards us. I ask that you would help us in the things that we've done wrong to turn around and make things right, Lord God, that you would give us the courage and the wisdom and the love to show your love to others. Make your will be done in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, so now you guys are going to get your little cups and do your whole offering thing, right? Is that? We're going to do the thing, or are we? Let's go to our seats, guys. Yeah. I'm gonna let you guys go to your seats now. You are dismissed. All right.
While we're waiting for people to come back, let's turn in our hymn books to number 294. 294. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power,
wonder-working power in the blood.
I will sing of my I will be reading 1 Corinthians 11:23-34. For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A bread and drinks of the cup. A man called out to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judge ourselves, we will not come under judgment. When we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for each other. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further directions. Let's pray for the bread. Heavenly Father, thank you as we are gathered here in your remembrance. We pray for the blessing of the bread symbolizing your body. Thank you, Lord. Please heal our bodies. I pray, my Lord, that you are with us in our hearts, in our minds, as we move forward. Bless the bread, my Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Bible also states in the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 26 to 29, and it says, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and then he gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, eat this. Take and eat. This is my body. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it all. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the wine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. We're going to go ahead and do the blessing and pray for the bread this morning and the wine. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Because this wine we're about to drink, it symbolizes that precious blood that was poured down on Mount Calvary for every single one of us. You being God, you having no necessity to come down, humiliated yourself, became one of us, and died for us, so that we one day can have this special ceremony with you in heaven. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your blood. And we ask you to bless it today in your name. Amen.
Stillness filled the heavens on crucifixion day. Some say it rained, I don't know if it's true. Well, I can just imagine 10,000 angels cry. That made it seem like rain to me. Angels all stood ready to take him from the tree. They waited for the words from his voice. But when he asked the Father, why hast thou forsaken me? They watched the Savior die of his own choice. I've never seen 10,000 angels cry, but I'm sure they did as they stood by and watched the Savior die. God turned his head away. He couldn't bear the sight. It must have seemed like rain when 10,000 angels cried. As the sun sleeps, the skies turn to gray, and when Jesus gave his all, that's when the tears began to fall. I've never seen 10,000 angels cry, but I'm sure they did. Watch the Savior die. God turned his head away. He couldn't bear the sight. It must have seemed like rain when 10,000 angels cried. It must have seemed.
Thank you.
The Bible says that when Jesus was with his disciples, he was about to be crucified. But that didn't matter to him. He did it for you and me. And as remembrance, we have been told by Jesus, do this until I come back again. As we drink this wine and eat this bread, let us remember that Jesus is coming soon. Let's all take part. It feels good to make a pact with Jesus, huh? How many of you guys is the first time that you've done this ritual? Anybody? First time here in the church? I think that today with the sermon, it reminded us that we're not going to be here for a long time. When will be the next communion service? I don't know. But one thing that I always tell my churches is, if you want to take this little cup home and with a Sharpie put a date on it and keep it as a reminder of when you committed yourself to God again. Each time you see it, you will remind yourself, I made a commitment with God. I made a pact with God, and I will not forget about it. As we finish, there will be a special offering that will be picked up outside for the benevolent fund. So we invite you guys to give some to that fund. It's where we take care of the needy, and also the children. We're going to have some children there that will be picking up their offering. And we invite you guys to also help them out. We're going to stand up and we're going to have the last song. And I'm going to invite the praise team to come over. Let's go ahead and bow our heads to have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Because even when you didn't have to, you sent your Son to deliver us from sin. Jesus, thank you so much. Because even when you didn't have to, you loved us so much that you died for us on the cross. And Holy Spirit, we ask you to please keep guiding us. Keep guiding us until we get to our final destination, where we'll have that huge communion service with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Be with us always. Stay with us and never leave us. We ask you all this, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.